4 days later, the UN Secretary General arrived to discuss the prospects of peace in Southeast Asia. In the opinion of U Thant, fresh from a tour of major capitals around the world, a settlement might result if certain demands from both sides could be mediated. The president emphasized that the San Antonio formula for mutual de-escalation of the conflict still remained the basis of American peace conditions. And he outlined to the Secretary General his hopes for the future.
They are the simplest things to describe, but they are the hardest to achieve. A peace rooted in the good, firm earth of freedom. A world respectful of law, given to justice, hostile only to force. A life without the torment of hunger and ignorance and disease. A higher standard of living and more opportunity for all.
Although he is constantly in touch with the nation's business from the Texas White House, the Johnson Ranch allows the president some precious moments of sheltered contemplation and privacy. While in Texas on this particular trip, the president made two official appearances. In Dallas, at a convention of the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association, Mr. Johnson saluted the continuing progress resulting from rural electrification, progress in which the president played a major role.
The REA was founded a third of a century ago to try to halt the drain of life and wealth from the countryside. Men and women rallied to the REA banner from all over America. And they did it for the same reason, to try to make life better in the rural areas. Not long ago, it was only 5% of America's farms had electricity. Today, only 5% don't have it. And I share your great pride in that progress, and I thank you for it. Because all along, your struggles have been my struggles. And so long as I am your president, I will do all in my power to work with you, to help you, to encourage you.
Later that evening, Mr. Johnson attended a birthday dinner in Austin, honoring an old friend, Governor John Conway. The next day, the president returned to Washington and top-level meetings on the continuing crisis in Vietnam. The most pressing matter to be settled involved the number of troop reinforcements General Westmoreland would need to maintain a fighting superiority. General Wheeler, just back from a fact-finding mission in Vietnam, laid the matter squarely before the National Security Council. But before finalizing a decision, the president ordered a further review of the situation. In the final days of the month, the president participated in two ceremonies honoring Defense Secretary Robert McNamara, who was moving from the Pentagon to the World Bank.
The General Services Administration does not list him among our official assets, but he is one of America's most valuable public properties. For many long and quite demanding years, Bob McNamara has guided the defense establishment. He has helped to give America the most efficient military strength in its history. And now, he's going to try to build the kind of world that alone can justify that strength. America is grateful for what he has done, and I speak for all of them this morning, and more important, for what he is about to do. May your selfless service spent in defending freedom bring even greater rewards in the larger work that you now undertake to promote freedom throughout all the world. Signed, Lyndon B. Johnson, the President of America.
Secretary McNamara received the Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian award. In an emotion-charged moment, the secretary faced a deeply moved audience.
Mr. President, I cannot find words to express what lies in my heart today. And I think I'd better respond on another occasion.
With the leave-taking of Secretary McNamara, the month drew to a close. For President Johnson, it had been a time of testing and a time of decision, a period when he exhibited the resolve of his nation.
So, we have taken our stand. The will of this generation of Americans will never be found wanting abroad or at home.